Good morning, students. Today we are starting the chapter number 6, Architecture and Power. In the previous chapter, we have discussed about the Mughal Empire, military campaigns of the Mughal emperors, their administrative policies, and their relationship with the other rulers. In this chapter, we will discuss why architecture is so important for our history. What are the famous monuments and structure built during this medieval period? What were the main features of the Mughal architecture? And which regional style of architecture developed during the medieval period? So, let's start. There are different books, records, inscriptions, and other documents which tell us about our history. But it is not possible for the common men to read those inscriptions or document. So, the only link with our past are the monuments. We can see, touch, and feel them directly. They take us back to the days when different activities took place within these forts and palaces. We can imagine how people in those days would go about daily businesses. In this chapter, we will read about some of these architectural monuments of medieval India. Power and public good. Why did the kings and emperors build monuments? Let's have the answer of this question. Abul Fazl talked about two types of building in his book Ani Akbari, that is palaces and forts. Now, what are these palaces and forts? Let's discuss this. Palaces. Palaces were built to give maximum comfort and pleasure to the members of the royal family. And on the other side, forts built by the ruler to defend their kingdoms against the attack of the enemies. It increased the military power of the builder. However, both of these had their own importance. While the strong forts prevent the enemies from attacking the kingdom, the beautiful palaces spread the fame of the empire far and wide. Thus, monumental architecture was a source of great prestige and glory for a kingdom or empire. Now, the emperor were not only content with building large forts and palaces alone. They also built structures such as sarais, tanks and wells, school and place of worship. These structures brought common people closer to the emperor. They also built temples and mosques. Temples were the tiny models of the world ruled by the king. Muslim rulers saw mosques as agents of God on earth. By building temples and mosques, rulers supported the learned and the holy men. Now let's discuss about the material, labor and designs. Monuments built in the medieval period give important information about the material, style of architecture, engineering methods and use of labor across the subcontinent. The type of raw material available in certain region influence the construction of material. Let's see some example. Hoysala architecture. Hoysala used the soft soap stone in the 12th and 13th century to create ornate means ornaments and intricate designs in their temple. On the other hand, due to hard rock granite available in Malappuram, Pallav temples display shallow relief as it was difficult to create delicate carving. Now in areas such as Bengal, where stone is not easily available, temples were constructed with the help of bricks. You can clearly see totally different style over here. Now let's talk about Dilwara temple. The Dilwara temple in Mount Abu are made of pure white marble. For plastering the building, gypsum or limestone was generally used, while white and red stone were the two stone used during the Mughal period. And other material used for the construction include wood, iron, cramps, iron door knockers, etc. Various types of laborers were employed in the construction and maintenance of such monuments. There were stone masons, carpenter, lime workers, latters, wicker workers, bricklayers, well diggers, varnish makers, etc. Most of the examples of architecture between the 7th and 12th centuries are temples in both North and South India. So let's discuss the North Indian temples and the South Indian temples. We'll start with the North Indian temples. The North Indian temples during this period were built in the Nagara style. The Nagara style, the main feature of the Nagara style is a beehive shaped tower called the Shikara. Have a look at this picture. This part is known as Shikara. The Shikara has a huge stone called Disc Amalka. This part is known as Amalka. There is a jug shaped Kalash at the tip of the Amalka. This part is known as Kalash. And the other part where this part is Garbhagriha, Ardh Mandap and the Mandap. Now the famous temples, some of the temples like Sun Temple at Konark, Kendri Mahadevya Deva Temple at Khajuraho and Jagannath Temple at Puri are some of the example of this architecture. Now the temples in South India were built in the Dravidian style. One of the important feature of Dravidian style is Viman or High Tower. Have a look at this picture. This is Viman, or you can say it is High Tower, that look like a pyramid. It has several stories of different sizes built over the Garbhagriha. This part is known as Garbhagriha. And the important feature, another important feature other than Viman, is Gopuram. Have a look at this picture. This is known as Gopuram. Now temple architecture of the south, in the south, became famous under the Cholas. The Kailash temple, the Bridheshwara temple and the Rajaraja temple are good example of the style of architecture. So students, now it's time for some brainstorming exercise. So let's start. In which style North Indian and South Indian temples were built? What do you understand by forts and palaces? Which rock was available in Mamallapuram? So students, give me the answer of these questions in the comment section below. Thank you. Have a good day.